Got a lot to go over on our prayer list here. We'll go ahead and get started right away with that. I lost my pen, so you're in trouble if I have to remember anything. Remember, Brother Ron Hughes, just got a text. He's having some issues with his stomach again, and he was planning on coming, and I think this kind of just happened. So if you would, just keep Ron in your prayers. Pray for him, and pray for C.R. and Betty Taylor from St. Paul, PH, over there. I think that's NR's dad, if I'm not mistaken. But C.R. and Betty are sick, and we need to pray for them. And Pastor Pete, J.C., told me that they weren't going to have service tonight because they had several that were sick. So just pray for that church. Pray for all of them, if you would. Amanda Edwards, that's John Edwards' wife. John's the guy that does our security on Sunday mornings back here and takes care of the doors and watches and all that. His father-in-law passed away. I was at the viewing today. His name was Sammy Somers. But his wife, Amanda, was her dad. So if you would, just keep that family in your prayers. Remember Randall's brother, Barry? He hurt his shoulder on the job. He's a truck driver, and he popped out the back of his trailer and fell and may have dislocated his shoulder. So remember Barry. And Matt Farrell, that's a guy that Randall works with at Duncan. He's to be remembered in prayer tonight, so we're going to remember Matt. And Dawn Garwood, that's Pastor Todd Garwood. That's his mother. She had a stroke this afternoon. And they got her to the ER, and they were able to give her the drugs, and she was regaining some consciousness the last I heard, just probably half an hour ago. But remember Dawn, if you would. That's Todd's mother. So do you have requests? Uplifted hand, and maybe those you would like to speak up. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, Daryl just told me that.
She was feeling better, but then I think everybody at the workplace was sick. And so it's more difficult coughing, sneezing, and all that.
Okay. Yeah, I want to pray for Sister Debbie, her and Jim Bowman. All right, I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, it's all right. My brother-in-law, I told you, had surgery again last week on the stent on his leg, and he's still having problems. They sent him to rehab, but it's still bleeding real bad, and he's having, I hope he don't have to go back to the hospital, but okay. He just needs prayer.
And that's Clarence.
Yes, Clarence, you've got a good memory.
No, I don't, I'll write it down. I can read, I have no memory, I can read, I look right here. Yeah, couldn't have a teleprompter. I remember it. But remember, continue to pray for Glenda. She's recovered well, but she's still sore and having some issues from her procedure. But if you would, just continue to keep her in your prayers. Somebody else you want to? Yeah, Darlene?
Remember my daughter, last night, her heart rate went so high that the doctor said if she hadn't stopped at the emergency room, if she'd have went on home, she'd have had a stroke.
My goodness, yeah. Yeah, keep her in your prayers. Yeah,
I remember it's a good friend of my mom's, Pat Corbin. Her husband died this week suddenly, so just remember her.
All right, Pat Corbin. Mm-hmm. Billy McComb told me yesterday his first cousin, his name was, I believe he said Garnet East. Some of you may know.
East Virgin, I think, yeah. Yeah. They live behind Nancy.
Right. That's where he said. He said he was killed in a car crash on Pulaski Mountain. But he hit him head on. I think he said he was 90. But I think the man used to come to church here. He had said years ago. So, but I remember it was at East. So let's keep that family in our prayers. Tell you, you never know. You get out there and you just Trust in the Lord. Somebody else.
Brenda Marshall, she's dead at George and her lady's not. Took a emergency room. They thought it was blood clots, mate, but they checked it wasn't done ultrasound. They couldn't find anything really.
All right, that's your wife. Or, all right. Yeah, Marie.
My daughter's best friend's sister's passed away. She's younger than my daughter.
Wow.
She had problems with diabetes and kidney failure, you know, dialysis and stuff. She was on her way to dialysis and she supposedly had been found in the ER.
Yeah. Well, I tell folks, on a good way or a good time, you just have to just deal with it. But it's all always a shock when it seems sudden. Well, I'm glad we got Jesus. I'm glad he's still alive and that he hears this and he knows this, and I don't have to hear, you know, these requests, and we don't have to give these requests without hope. Because I know that the Lord does miracles. It's amazing, everything that he's able to do. So we're just going to lift all these up in prayer that we have mentioned here, and all the hands that were raised. Anybody else, and always, if you'd like to come get a prayer cloth for somebody, we do that on Wednesday too. If you want to come up to the altar and be prayed for, be prayed with, as I put it, you're welcome to do that as well. So let's all go to God in prayer together, okay? Most gracious Heavenly Father and Almighty God, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we come here tonight as your servants, as disciples, as those, Father, who believe in you. And we know that as we give out these requests, that there are numerous other needs that we're not even aware of, but you are. And we just thank you that you gave us that privilege. You give us the opportunity to bring all these things up to you, Lord. For without you, we would be helpless. We would be in this world without hope. So, Father, we're not, because you not only listen to us, but you answer us. So we're just praying for these, everyone that was named off, whatever that need may be tonight. We lift them up in prayer. We hold up all those in our church, in our community that are sick, Sister Debbie and the Taylors and the St. Paul folk, and all those who work in their cities throughout their families. We know that you're the healer. We know that you can touch and you can heal. And we just pray for that. We just ask you to minister to those who are in the room tonight. And pray for Brother Dobbs, Father, that although they didn't find anything, she will still be almighty. You touched her, you healed her, she'll be okay. And pray for Todd's mom, and pray for Don, and ask that you just keep your hand upon her. Will be done there as we know that you're able to heal and help her recover completely. This one that lost his sister, I'll minister to that family. That's going to be a hard thing. So now, as we continue throughout our service tonight, we're going to glorify you. We're going to lift your name here in the sanctuary in just a moment. We're going to worship you through our giving, and then we're going to worship you in song. Then we'll worship you in this word. We give you all the thanks and all the praise, because it's all about you, Jesus. It's in your wonderful name we pray. All that love you would say, we love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
Amen and amen. Brother Randall, it's going to come. See the offer. That's the blessing, my brother.
Amazing grace, how sweet the
Oh, there's an old word for grace, but amazing. Hello, Brother Dave. Good to see you, buddy. All right. Well, chapter 26. I tell you, this is something that's got a little nerve for me. Teach a whole chapter. Well, y'all, I will be here for 5 hours. No, you know better than that. No, it's just, as I told you before, it's the fact that, you know, Luke's book in this part of it is really a narrative. It has to do with, I guess we could just call it the story. You know, pretty much so, the story of Jesus and how the church got started. So he doesn't zero in on a lot of theological details, but occasionally he'll throw something in there. And we pretty much covered that in the opening chapters as the church began to take root in society. Then the beliefs and all that they believed and were preaching, we pretty much talked about it at the outstart because they was put on trial for what they had taught and all those things. So now, as we finish out and we go to the rest of the book, we're zeroing in on the Apostle Paul, who is going to Rome. That's where Jesus said he would go. Remember, he said he'll speak before kings and you know, governors, and then you will go for me to Rome. You go to Rome. So nothing's going to sidetrack that. He's on his way. But it's interesting to see all the things that took place before he got to Rome. And of course, once he gets to Rome, then that's when the church took off and was really spread throughout the rest of the world. So right now, we're going to look at chapter 26. Now, this is following up. Luke records this, what I call a trial, which is really what it is, in regards to Festus and King Agrippa that Paul has to stand before. So as Festus had said last week, when we had studied last week, he said, you know, it's not right to try a guy unless you hear him first, unless you hear all the charges that are against him. And that was following Roman law. So it just so happened that King Agrippa and Bernice, and I told you about them two, they happened to come down for a diplomatic visit. It had nothing to do with Paul. But while they were there, Festus used that situation. He took advantage of that because King Agrippa was seeing the Jews. And he used him to help him in hearing Paul, in Paul's defense. So this will give Festus, if you want to say, a counselor, somebody that can listen to what Paul says and be able to advise him as to what he should do in regards to that. So let's look, we're going to start at chapter 26. And Agrippa wanted to hear Paul himself, and Festus said, okay, the next day you're going to hear him. So then the next day, they brought him in. And when he came in, everybody had been seated, starting with verse 1. Then Agrippa said to Paul, you're permitted to speak for yourself. So Paul stretched out his hand and answered for himself. I'm glad I'm not the only one that uses my hands to talk. Paul couldn't say a word a day unless it. So he stretched out his hand. And he answered for himself. And he said, I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because today I shall answer for myself before you concerning all the things of which I am accused by the Jews, especially because you are expert in all the customs and the questions which have to do with the Jews, because he's king of the Jews. Therefore, I beg you to hear me patiently. Now, my manner of life from my youth, which was spent from the beginning among my own nation at Jerusalem, all the Jews know, they knew me from the first. Now, if they were willing to testify that, according to the strictest sect, of our religion, they would have to testify that I live as a Pharisee. And now I stand and am judged for the hope of the promise made by God to our fathers. To this promise, our 12 tribes, earnestly serving God night and day, hope to attain. For this hope's sake, King Agrippa, I'm accused by the Jews. Now, why should it be thought incredible by you that God raises the dead? Indeed, I myself thought I must do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And this I also did in Jerusalem. And in many of the saints, I shut up in prison, having received authority from the chief priests. And when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. That's the same thing as throwing a rock at them. He cast his vote against them. And I punished them often in every synagogue and compelled them to blaspheme. And being exceedingly enraged against them, I persecuted them, even to foreign cities. So then, while thus occupied, as I journeyed to Damascus with authority and commission from the chief priest, arrest warrants, at midday, O king, along the road I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun. Now this was midday when he saw that light, and it was brighter than the sun, shining around me and those who journeyed with me. And when we all had fallen to the ground, I heard a voice speaking to me and saying in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. And that, what that means is, goads were pointy sticks that they used to keep livestock in certain fenced-in areas. They didn't have a gate, but these sticks would be pointed. They would be pointed towards the field that the animals were in, so they couldn't get over them. They would stick their feet on them real sharp points, so they wouldn't go across them. And Jesus uses that illustration, and he said, it's hard for you to kick against the goats. So I said, who are you, Lord? Now that word Lord is sir, S-I-R. And it's interchanged sometimes. So we call Jesus Lord. It's usually all capital letters most of the time. But he said, who are you, Lord? Who are you, sir? And Jesus said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Wouldn't you like to see the look on Paul's face when he heard that? You know, the one that you're killing all these people who keep saying that I'm alive and you're tracking them down and throwing them in prison, well, I'm the one you're actually persecuting. I would have been shaken because you think he's going to go, that's the end of it. But look what he said. He said, but rise and stand on your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness, both of the things which you have seen and of the things which I will yet reveal to you. I will deliver you from the Jewish people as well as from the Gentiles, to whom I now send you, to open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who were sanctified by faith in me. Now, therefore, King Agrippa, Paul said, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first to those in Damascus and in Jerusalem, and throughout all the region of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent, turn to God, and do works befitting repentance. For these reasons, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. So therefore, having obtained help from God, to this day I stand, witnessing both to small and great, important people and non-important people, saying no other things than those which the prophets and Moses said would come, that the Christ would suffer, that he would be the first to rise from the dead, and would proclaim light to the Jewish people and to the Gentiles. Now, as he thus made his defense, Festus said with a loud voice, got to that old Roman governor, didn't he? And he yelled out with a loud voice, Festus did. And he said, Paul, you are beside yourself. Another word for that is, you are mad. Or another word for that is, you're a maniac. Much learning is driving you mad. You're a maniac. But he said, Paul said, I'm not mad. I'm not a maniac, most noble Festus. But I speak the words of truth and reason. For the king, a lot like this right here, for the king before whom I also speak freely, he knows these things. For I am convinced that none of these things escapes his attention, since this thing was not done in a corner, wasn't done in secret. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? Didn't give him a chance to answer, but he would have had to say, yeah, because he's the king of the Jews. He said, I know that you do believe. And then Agrippa said to Paul, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. Wonder if he ever did. Wonder if Agrippa ever, huh?
I wondered that same
thing. Yeah, wonder if, I mean, it's not for us to know, I guess, but you have to wonder. He said, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. And Paul said, I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me today might become both almost and altogether such as I am. Well, except for these chains, we wouldn't be prisoners. So when he had said these things, the king stood up, as well as the governor and Bernice, and those who sat with them. And when they had gone aside, they talked among themselves. And Luke said, this is what they said. This man is doing nothing deserving of death or chains. Now, I don't know if I come from the Roman governor or Agrippa or both. And then Agrippa said to Festus, this man might have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar. He might have been set free. No, he's got to go to Rome. He has to go to Rome. King Agrippa didn't realize that, but Paul did. Father, I thank you. I thank you for this text. I thank you for this word. So now, Lord, as we continue on our journey into the foundation of this wonderful, glorious church that we're a part of, it's encouraging. It's encouraging us as disciples to see your hand in working among your people, so that whether we stand before paupers or whether we stand before princes, it's the same message, and you're there with us to get it. And we'll give you the thanks and praise for everything you do. So now, help us to hide this word in our hearts, that we might be better disciples, better yet, that we might be better evangelists. In your name we ask it by faith, Lord, and all the saints that say we love you, Lord. Amen and amen. All right. Take me a swig. Let's look at your notes. This chapter is the hinge pin. That's my word. Upon which Christianity spread throughout the world by Paul. From a worldly standpoint, he could have been convicted by the Jews and running, and ended up being put to death just as Jesus was. Remember now, he's on trial for sedition. He's on trial for stirring up riots in the Roman provinces. That's what he is being tried for. And sedition against Rome is punishable by death. And that's what got Jesus crucified. But it was God's plan for that to happen, just as it's God's plan for Paul to be here. Now, we know that it was not going to happen. We know they weren't going to free him or kill him. Except for Paul, though, the rest of those in the court that day did not know. The Jews that were there and the great men of the city that came in and all of them that were listening on the trial, everybody in the courtroom that day, they really didn't know what they were going to do with it. But here's the good thing about it. They all got to hear the message of the resurrected Christ. All of them got to hear it. Now, regardless of what they do with that message, it doesn't matter whether they believe it or whether they don't believe it, it's still true. So they are held responsible for their belief and not for the fact that Paul preached it. So they have to be responsible since they heard that message. So that's one of the reasons that Paul said, I find myself happy. I think myself happy because he loved to preach the gospel. He loved to spread it. And you couldn't find a better group to preach it to than these. And God had put him right in that place. All right, on your notes, in verses 1 through 11, we'll take the whole section here. Paul began by telling them his involvement with the Jewish religion, because he's mainly testifying to Agrippa, because he knows Festus doesn't care about any of this stuff, but he knows Agrippa knows this stuff. It's not new to him. So he started with his involvement in the religion, and that many of the Jews knew him to start with. They probably knew of his family. They knew he sat at the feet of Gamaliel. They knew he was a rabbi. He said, I'm a Pharisee of the Pharisees. They knew who Paul was. So for him to come and tell them, you know, that Jesus is alive, then they just simply, well, you think they would have said, what changed, Paul? I mean, you were trying to annihilate us, you know, annihilate the heretics, and now you're one of them. So what was it that changed? But they never got to that point. They just deemed him, well, he's an insurrectionist, and he's trying to come against Rome. He became a Pharisee, and as Agrippa knows, they believe in what? The resurrection of the dead. Pharisees believe in the resurrection of the dead. Remember, that's what got Paul here to start with. Remember that first hearing when he was drugged before the Sanhedrin? And he realized that there were some Sadducees in the group, and there were some Pharisees in the group, and there was another group called the Essenes, E-S-S-N-E-S, where we're different from both of those. That's where we get the Dead Sea Scrolls, was from that group. And they believed a little bit of Sadducee and Pharisee doctrine. But in that room where they were at, if you remember, he said, I'm being tried here today because I believe in the resurrection of the dead, remember? And then all the Pharisees had to take up for him. And they said, we don't see nothing wrong with this guy. And that's when the riot broke out, and he was about to tear him apart, and he had to be rescued by the commander. So the Pharisees believe in the resurrection of the dead. And we've got scriptures that I'll go through here. That's why I give you that other sheet. Those other notes, I went ahead and got them for you. So we can see that they do believe in the resurrection. So then he tells them that he too was against the teaching that Jesus had risen from the dead and was the Messiah. Paul says, I was against it I was contrary to it. And a Messiah who would come to earth and establish an eternal kingdom into which all those who believe would be raised from the dead. And he also told me that he took it upon himself to put a stop to it. Isn't that interesting? He's a Pharisee. He wasn't asked to do the job. He wasn't assigned by the Sanhedrin to do it. He just tells Agrippa, I was contrary to the teaching of Jesus Christ, so then I'm the one who went and had him put in prison, and when they would vote to kill him, I would cast my vote to kill them, because he believed they were heretics. He believed that. He really did. So he said, I pretty much took it upon myself to put a stop to it. Now in verses 12 through 18, then he begins to recount his encounter with Jesus himself and what he was told by Jesus. That's why I say we can have confidence in what Paul says in his letters. Now, we don't worship Paul. I mean, we don't make a super saint out of Paul. Paul was a vessel that Christ used as part of his church, just like all of us are. And we may not all be given the assignment that Paul was given by Christ. But once we come to Christ, once we become a disciple, it becomes our same responsibility to tell others about him, just like it was Paul's responsibility to tell others about him. That's part of being a Christian and a disciple. So he began to tell him that he had this encounter with Christ. Now, there's two things to note when he says what Jesus said to him here in these verses. After he had asked him, you know, to stand to his feet, he says in verse 16, I have appeared to you for this purpose. For this purpose. Now here's the key why Paul did what he did. Number one, to make you a minister and a witness, both of the things which you have seen up to this point, and of the things which I will yet reveal to you. On your notes, two things to note. Witness to what is happening right now. And that is exactly what Paul was doing in front of King Agrippa and Festus. Jesus said, you're going to be a witness to what you have seen. You've seen the light. You've seen me knock you off the horse. You've heard me. So you're going to be a witness to this very event. And that's exactly what he's doing right now. He's witnessing that event. And then Jesus said, and you will also be a minister and a witness to the things which I will yet reveal to you. Jesus will later reveal it to him. And that was when he took him into the Arabian wilderness for 3 years. Remember that when we studied the book of Corinthians? Paul said, I remember a man 14 years ago, whether in the body or out of the body. I can't really say for sure, but I was taken up to the third heaven, and I was shown things which were inexpressible for words to express. Remember that? That's what Jesus was talking about when he told Paul, you're not only witness to what you've seen here today, but you're going to be a witness to the things I'm going to tell you. I think I put your scripture references on there for that. 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 6, and the whole first chapter of Galatians. Man, that chapter in Galatians, that's an excellent chapter. Because Paul is arguing against philosophy to the Galatian church. And that whole first chapter of Galatians is pretty much his testimony of how he came to know what he knows about Jesus. And that's the whole first chapter of Galatians. Not very long, but if you get a chance, read that, because that's a great testimony. And then verse 18, in that section, Jesus said, this is why to do it, is to open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light. Remember what John said in his gospel? John 1, in his first opening chapter of his gospel, he said light had come in to the world, but people love darkness rather than light, so they were drawn to the darkness. Well, Jesus told Paul is to open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to the power of God. How many believe that Satan has power over people?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. I mean, he'll look. You serve one or the other. Bob Seger was right in his song, right? My old hippie days. Yeah. Bob Seger and the Silver Bullet, man, you're going to serve somebody. Either it's the Lord or it's the devil, but you are going to serve somebody. Bob was right. There is no in between. You're either in the light of the kingdom or you're in the darkness of Satan. That's just how it is. But see, we have to be delivered from that in order to turn us. And Christ is able to do that. We couldn't just come out of it on our own. But Christ, God, made a way through Jesus that we can come out of it once we decide we need to come out of it. So darkness to light and sanctified. Now here we have a holiness doctrine, a PH doctrine. They may receive forgiveness of sins, number one, and an inheritance among those. An inheritance means that they will reap the eternal life. Those who are sanctified by faith in me. Jesus said in John 17, in his prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said, I sanctify myself that they might be sanctified in us. That word sanctify and sanctification means to separate from, or to be apart from, or to be set above. When you and I come to Christ, he sets us apart from those who are not his by doing what for us? What does he do for me and you that sets us apart from the ones who are not his?
Saves us. Comes in our heart and saves us.
Yeah. He gives us his Holy Spirit. You're right, Shannon. He saves us. He gives us that Holy Spirit to come into our hearts. That's what sets us apart from the unbelievers. There's nothing different from us than a pagan. There's nothing humanly different. The only thing that separates us from them, if you want to put it that way, is the Holy Spirit who is in our hearts. We can't do it ourselves. That's why he said, you know, salvation is by grace and not by works. None of us can brag about what we have done in order to be saved. Because no matter what we do, we can't be saved by ourselves. Jesus said, what would a person give in exchange for their own soul? In other words, what do you have that you can buy eternal life with? And you know what the answer to that is?
Nothing.
So he gave it all. He gave what was needed to us. And when we take it, when we accept that, then we become separated from the lost and put into his kingdom. As he told the Roman church, we are adopted as sons and daughters into his kingdom by way of the Holy Spirit that's in our hearts. That's what sanctification is. That is sanctified. That is set apart. Set apart for Christ, which is what the church is. Well, why did I say the word for church really meant? When we talked about the Greek word for church, what did I say that that word actually meant for church? It means to come out of. The church comes out of a group. You got a group of people, you got a group of humans on the earth, and then those who believe in Christ by faith and accept him by faith, and he comes into our hearts by way of his Holy Spirit, we are pulled out of the dying human group, and we're put into another group who will live eternally in the kingdom. That's the church. That come out of you. And the only way to come out of is for him to draw us and to sanctify us and make it happen. Now, that why did I say that's a PH doctrine? That's one of our doctrines. We certainly believe in being sanctified and set apart. Now listen carefully here. Sanctification doesn't mean sinless perfection. Now, the holiness associated with sanctification is simply saying we have no righteousness, but the only righteousness I can claim is that which is imputed unto me by way of Jesus Christ through his Holy Spirit. I have no righteousness. Isaiah said if I did, it would be filthy rags. So I don't have any righteousness. That's why Billy Graham always used to say, no matter how good you are, you'll never be good enough. And that is true. Because it's not about good people don't go to heaven. Saved people go to heaven. See? So Jesus told him, I want you to let the people know that. That is sanctification. You are pulled apart. How? By faith in me. Not in the sacrifices of bulls and goats no longer. Not in any system that man comes up with, but only by faith in Christ. That's how it happens. And that's why Jesus said, I sanctify myself. How did Jesus sanctify himself? By going to the cross. By going to the cross and dying for the sin, even though he had none, he separated himself from the sin for our sake by shedding his blood. And when we accept that death, then we are sanctified by his death and that not of our own. And I know that sounds real deep and real complicated and real college level, but listen, that's just what he did. That's what sanctification is about. It is having the Holy Spirit. Now, it is an ongoing process. Sanctification begins at the moment when Christ comes into our heart. But I don't think there's any one of us here, or those who are watching, who could say that the moment that Christ came into your heart, you were perfect from that moment on. Am I the only one that was? Wow, what's a lightning bolt get? No, it's a learning process. And we learn through what the Word teaches, and we learn through prayer, and we learn through fellow Christians. It's a learning process, but it's carried out by the Holy Spirit. He's the one that does that. But because look at you. You're a special group here tonight. I mean, think of people that you know, who are they and what are they doing? But you're here in Bible study. Well, what makes you different from them? because the Holy Spirit draws you into that relationship with Him, and you say, "Well, I want to hear some more about it." That's how it works. Now, in verses 19 through 23, knowing the Scriptures, Paul being a Pharisee, and when you talk about the Scriptures that Paul had was the Old Testament, the Law and the Prophets. That's what they went by. There was no New Testament. It was the Law and the Prophets. And Paul knew them up one side and down the other. He was a rabbi, so he knew them. Starting at verse 19, he tells him, "I wasn't disobedient to the heavenly vision. No, I think if Jesus knocked me down in the road and blinded me and said, 'Stand up, go do this,' I think I would say, 'Thank you, I'll do it. So he said, "I wasn't disobedient to the heavenly vision." He did what Christ had told him to do. So knowing the Scriptures, now he turns this to King Agrippa right here, verse 21. "For these reasons," he said, "the Jews seized me in the temple. They seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. Therefore, having obtained help from God, to this day I stand." Yeah, witnessing both to the small and the great. And watch what he says here. "Saying no other things." Paul said, "I am not teaching a new doctrine. I am not teaching a new religion. I am not offering up to you a new God in Jesus." He said, "I am teaching you no other things than those which the prophets and Moses said would come." And those are found, make a note of these, did I leave them on there? Deuteronomy 18, okay. Read those when you get a chance, because those verses I have listed for you there are the verses or the Scriptures in the Old Testament that talks about Jesus' suffering, death, and His resurrection. That's in the Old Testament that Paul says, "I was preaching." Now, let's look at your notes, that sheet that I gave you. The Scriptures from the Old Testament regarding general resurrection from the dead. That's why Paul said to King Agrippa, you shouldn't think it's incredible to be raised from the dead. Why? Because it's taught. It's taught in the Scriptures. It's taught in the Old Testament. Here's the Old Testament Scriptures alluding to life after death, to resurrection. The first one is Job chapter 19. Job said, "I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on the earth." It's coming, isn't it? At the end of the tribulation, that's going to happen. "And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God." Well, how's that going to happen? Resurrected. Wasn't Jesus resurrected into a glorious body? Job says, "I know, even though I'm destroyed, I'm still going. In my flesh I'll see him, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. Oh, how my heart yearns within me." Job believed in the resurrection. Psalm 17. David said, "As for me, I will see your face in righteousness, and I shall be satisfied when I do what? When I awake in your likeness." Well, isn't that what Paul told the Corinthians at the Thessalonians? "For at the last trump, the trumpet will sound, and all the dead in Christ shall be raised first. And the rest of us will be caught up together with him in the air, and we shall all forever be with the Lord." So Isaiah said, "Your dead shall live." Note that, not any dead, but your dead. Your dead shall live. Together with my dead body, they shall rise. So Isaiah said right there, I'm going to rise, and they're going to rise with me. Awake and sing, you who dwell in the dust, for your dew is like the dew of herbs, and the earth shall do what? Cast out the dead. You can bury us, but when Christ comes, it ain't going to make no difference. We're gone. Ain't no grave going to hold my body down, Bill Monroe said. And John used to do a great job saying that. The earth will cast it out. Daniel said, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. Ooh, some to everlasting life, and then some to shame and everlasting content. Yeah, what happened? And Hosea said, I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. O death, I will be your plagues. O grave, I will be your destruction. Talking about Christ. Pity is hidden from my eyes as towards death. There's no pity to Christ in that. Paul quotes these scriptures in a different way in Corinthians. He says, O death, where is your sting? Exactly what he said. Death, where is it? And he says, O grave, there you go. See? So it's there. It's there. So King Agrippa knew that, and Paul played upon that. Well, I say play upon that. It wasn't planned, but he was telling the truth. So Paul affirms he only preached what was in the law and the prophets, which is what we were reading, and that's what's given out in Deuteronomy. Now, verses 24 through 29, the Roman governor did not believe in the resurrection of the dead, and therefore he accuses Paul of being a maniac. That word is maniac. The Greek word is maniac. Well, that's where we get our English word maniac. He's a maniac. A maniac. He didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead, and therefore accuses Paul of being a maniac. I like the way it happens when he had him on the edge of his seat and he just had to yell out, didn't he? You're crazy. You're crazy. Ain't nobody raised from the dead. He attributed, here's the kicker. He attributed that to Paul's education by the Jews. Whew. That Roman governor, you talk about sticking your foot in the mouth. I mean, go back and look at this in this chapter. As thus he made his defense, verse 24, Festus said with a loud voice, Paul, you are beside yourself. You're out of your mind. Much learning is driving you mad. Now, what did Paul learn? What he learned? He's a Jew. Who taught him about the resurrection? The Jews. Who's the Roman governor sitting beside of? The king of the Jews. So he just now said, Paul, these guys have taught you the wrong things. You're mad because of all this learning that you have got from them. You think Agrippa would have stood up and said, I'm insulted. Because he wrote it right at him, Dave. He said, you're mad. That much learning has made you mad. Well, Paul was a Pharisee. So was Agrippa. He had to be before he could become king. So he said his education by the Jews. So then Paul then alludes to Agrippa. And he puts Agrippa on the spot. Agrippa, who believes the same thing. Agrippa couldn't say it's not true because he believed what the scriptures said. He said, I know. He said, the king before whom I speak freely knows these things. In other words, Festus, He's got the same education I have. If I'm mad, he's mad. If I'm out of my mind, he's out of his mind. Because we both were trained and learned the same thing. And then he says, King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? He had to say he believed the prophets. He was the king of the Jews. If he had said, well, I'm not sure, the Jews in that room, there had been no riot. They had took the king and Bernice off that throne. Yeah. So he didn't answer. Paul says, I know that you do believe because you're a king, you're a Pharisee, you're a Jew, I know you believe. And then he goes on to tell him, he said, none of this has escaped your attention. Since this thing was not done in a corner, this thing not done in secret, what is the thing that Paul's talking about? That he knows, King Agrippa knows what he's talking about. What is the thing?
The resurrection.
There you go. The resurrection of Christ. That's the thing. When Paul said it was done right under your nose, it wasn't done in secret. You knew what was going on. You knew when Jesus was crucified. You knew that they said he was raised from the dead. You knew all this. And you believed the prophets. You believed in the resurrection. So now you're having trouble believing that Jesus was resurrected, even though you believe in the resurrection. Now, that's a pretty good argument, isn't it? He made a good argument, but God was with him. And then when he told him that, Agrippa said, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. Now, on your note, Agrippa was either he was being sarcastic, or he was really moved by Paul's testimony of meeting Jesus. One of the two. There's no way he can know. He could read anything into that he wants to. When he said, I'm almost persuaded to become a Christian. Did he say it smart alecky? Or did he say it sincerely? We don't know. You can't get that from a written word. All we do know is he said it. Whether it was being sarcastic or whether it was being real. If he sincerely, you know, you make a good point, Paul. I mean, I do believe in the resurrection. So why shouldn't I believe that Christ was resurrected if I believe in the resurrection? Remember, Paul made a good argument for that to the Corinthian church. Remember when we studied Corinthians? He said, if the dead are not raised, then Christ is not raised, and we're all still in our sins. But the dead is raised, and Christ was raised, and has justify us before God. So we're no longer in our sins. So in verse 30 and 32, they had a sidebar, and Agrippa said to Festus, this man might have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar. Because again, there was no evidence in Paul's testimony that he's a threat to Rome. He was a threat to Rome. And apparently Festus would have freed him, probably. But God had other plans. See, it was the turning point of the church, because if Rome had found him guilty, if Agrippa had taken the side of Festus, just like Pilate took the side of the Jews, if he had taken that side, then Paul could have been killed as an insurrectionist. He could have been killed as a seditionist, as a rebel against Rome. That could have happened right there in that trial. It could have happened. But God was with Paul. Paul said, I stand here today by God's help. So it wasn't going to happen. Paul knew it wasn't going to happen. Paul knew he was going to Rome. Everybody else did. Luke didn't know. Luke recorded these things. Luke was probably in the room. There was false people in there. So he recorded those things. And he knew that wasn't going to happen. So the fact that he wasn't found guilty either by Rome or by Agrippa. Because Agrippa knew if he was telling the truth about the resurrection, that's why he was on trial, because he had said, "I believe in the resurrection." It stirred everybody up. And Agrippa couldn't say, "Well, that's wrong," because Agrippa believed in the resurrection too. It was in the scriptures. So they could have killed him, or they could have freed him. They could have said, "Okay, just go your own way." What do you think would have probably happened to Paul if they had released him that day? I mean, the Bible doesn't tell us exactly what would happen to him, but we know for a fact that there was a group of Jews who were laying wait to kill him. There were assassins everywhere. If he wasn't under protective guard, if he got kicked out of jail, he wouldn't be in a witness protection program. He would have been on the street. How long do you think he would have lasted? Yeah. So God says, no, he's not going to be set free. He's not going to be killed. He's going to Rome. And there, he will meet his Waterloo, so the Pope used to say. There is where he will meet his death, is in Rome. But until he gets there, it's not going to happen. Next week, we'll look at verses 1 through 12 and verse 27, because then we're starting the treacherous journey to Rome. Questions or comments on this chapter? No, pretty cut and dry. Did you have any idea of what all the church was up against when you look at it today? And you think it's always been this way. You think it's always been.
Two years after they killed Paul.
Huh?
Agrippa and Bernice killed themselves on an island because they messed up with the Caesar.
Yeah.
According to what I read in about Roman history.
Yeah, once Paul was at Rome and goes before Caesar, he's going to go before him. They put his trial off. We'll see that. But once he gets there, then that's where the message is going to spread. And that's where we get the history of the Roman Catholic Church, which is the authority on church history. I just put it that way. They are. They have more history than no other denomination existed. So they were
all
there.
The idea to get crucified upside down, or the Jews, by the Romans?
Yeah, legend said Peter was. Said Peter was crucified upside down. Paul was beheaded a year ago.
Well, who was crucified upside down?
Peter. Now, that's what legend says.
But what the Romans did him the same way. They killed him, didn't they?
What's that?
Paul and Peter.
Yeah, Paul, they cut his head off. He was beheaded.
All of them, except for John, if I might think I'm right on it, he's the only one that wasn't killed. All the rest of them were killed, and the people, or the governor, or whoever sentenced them to death, they died later because of some of the stuff that they done.
Yeah.
God was great.
Yeah, all the first apostles died except John. John eventually died. Now, legend has it, that he was boiled in oil and didn't die, and that's why that he was exiled to the Isle of Patmos, to get rid of him so he wouldn't be able to witness, within the world. Now, that's what legend has. Whether it's true or not, doesn't matter. What we know is he was on the Isle of Patmos. Because that's where he got the revelation. Legend, and I say legend, has that, but you know how rumors are. But if it ain't here, it may have been. So, and it's neither here nor there, like I said, Paul was on the Isle, or John was on the Isle of Patmos. But secular history does record that Nero beheaded Paul. Yeah, he killed him in Rome. Yeah. Anybody else? Father, we thank you tonight for these who are here, these who have tuned in, those who will watch us on YouTube, and maybe even on our website. I see on our website that people go there sometimes and watch it. So we just thank you, Lord, that you're using all these means to get this word out, because we know, Lord, that it's your word that does the work. It's not our words, it's your words. So I pray now as we go from here, as I said at the outstart, that we hide this word in our hearts. Not only that we don't sin against you, but that we might be better disciples and better evangelists. In your wonderful name we pray, Jesus, and all saints that say, love you, Lord. Amen. And amen. And I built my Bible. Joe, would you quit laughing?